so we can make sure that we're up here in an hour. So, welcome. We're excited that you're here. We're also videotaping this, so we'll be posting a version of this online for other families to watch. So it's a little awkward for us, but it'll hopefully catch your questions and anything that comes up as well. Come on in. So I'm Misty. I'm the director of Camp Otakota, and yeah, I guess we should. I can do some introduction slides. So we have been doing camp. This is our eighth camp. We started camp when our son was 10 years old, and he just graduated from high school. So we've been doing this for 8 years. When he was 10, he was really struggling with finding others that understood him. We really wanted him to go to summer camp, and we hatched a plan to take him to Minnesota. And we were going to drive there. I was going to get a hotel. I had this whole plan because I just felt like it was so unfair that he couldn't go to camp and my other kids could. And my husband and I grew up going to camp, and we both felt it was really important for him. So we didn't go to Minnesota, but we started Camp Otakota. Our first year, we started with 35 kids. Good morning. 35 kids, which I still am like sometimes looking back thinking, how? 35 parents trusted us with their kids for like just, woo, yes, take your kids. And it was fantastic. That was a really, really awesome year. We had 15 adults, 35 kids, and we learned a lot. And in 8 years, we've grown. We have 85 campers and a wait list, usually pretty long wait list. So definitely our program has grown and developed, and we have a lot of fun. So, our mission, I'm not going to read everything to you, but I think this is important because especially we don't do any therapy at our camp. It's all about just being able to experience what typical peers experience, having the fun of going to summer camp. There's something magical about how close you feel to other people when you've spent an entire week with them at summer camp. And so that's really what we're all about is we want to provide opportunities for kids with autism to enjoy their uniqueness, take pride in their strengths, and have fun. So that's basically our goal. I think there's going to be slides about introductions. Meet the staff. Feel confident about leaving your kids with us. So this is Amy, and I'll let her introduce herself.
Sure. I'm Amy Costanza Smith, and this will be my fifth year at camp. In my day job, I'm a speech language pathologist and a professor at PSU. At camp, I am not. Because it's not a therapeutic camp. I camp, I'm a counselor, and it's so much fun.
Okay, and Jimmy, would you like to introduce yourself?
I'm Jimmy Baldwin. This is my fourth year, and I'm working towards my master's in special education at WASU.
Okay, thanks, Jimmy. Come on in.
Sorry.
You're good. No problem. Welcome. I'm Michaela.
I'm Michaela Phillips Cook. It's going to be my third year at camp. I am a paraeducator at an elementary school.
And Michaela is available if anybody wants to make a payment today. She will be accepting payments. You don't have to make it today. If you'd like to do it online, we do have a button on our website that you can donate it through that. Or if you'd like to leave a check, you don't have to do it today, but she's available if you'd like to do that. Okay, that's my family. So I have three boys. That's my husband, Ian, who also comes to camp. He calls himself an innocent bystander at camp, but he actually does come to camp. He pretends like he doesn't deserve. And this is Corinne. Corinne couldn't be here today. She's the assistant director. She runs all of our behavior programs and generally oversees our counselors as well. She lives in Medford, near Medford, and she's an ABA therapist there. So it's a little bit of a drive for her to come up here. But that's her husband Luke and her three girls. Okay. These are things we're going to talk about today. We're going to talk about camp. We're going to answer your questions. If you would like to purchase any camp swag, we are cleaning out. So we have $10 sweatshirts, $5 t-shirts, and a bunch of stuff up here. Basically, our costs. We're just trying to kind of clean that out. So take a look before you leave. You can pay a balance with Michaela. We don't need you to RSVP for the dinner on the first night, but we'll talk a little bit about that when we get to that area. Okay. So just like at school, any medications that come to us are going to need to be in their original packaging. What we do is we want you to bring everything in the original bottle in a Ziploc bag. So when we first check into camp, the way it works we invite you to come at 4 o'clock, and from 4 to 5:30 we do check-in, and at 5:30 we have a barbecue for all the families. So we're hoping that you'll join us for that. It's a great time for you to get to know the counselors, for the kids to feel comfortable, to meet a few friends before you leave them. But during that first hour, one of the things that you'll do is you'll go to the nurse, and we have a fantastic nurse named Heidi, who's been with us since the very first year of camp, and she comes every year. She works at Salem Hospital, and she brings out several nurses from Salem Hospital for the first night check-in, and they are so amazing. As you can imagine, there's lots of supplements and lots of meds that come along with our kids, and by the time we are done with check-in, they have pretty much every kid. They put the meds for each meal into little envelopes with a label on it with their picture, the name of the med, and the time of day they're going to get it, and they have them all laid out for us for the whole week, like within 2 hours. They're so fantastic. Yeah, so you will feel comfortable. When you meet Heidi, you can give her your meds. She's really aware of how things work, and she will take all that in, ask you questions, take some notes, and then she will manage it throughout the week. We do not require health forms anymore. We used to require a sports physical, but we're not requiring that anymore. The only form you'll need is the one I emailed in this packet was, there's a medication form. So if some kids are on no medications, so you don't, if you are on no medications, you don't need to fill out that form, but there is, we would still like you to check in with the nurse, because she will ask you to sign whether you would like your child to receive Tylenol or Motrin or Benadryl if needed. So still check in with the nurse, but basically you just bring your medication form to Heidi when you check in. That's the only medication form that will do. Okay, so things to know before camp. So in the packet I sent you, there is a packing list. Label everything. Now sometimes kids don't want you to label their items. What we've done in the past is have them make some way to identify it. So if it's a black dot in the right corner or whatever, you know, just so that there is some identifiable mark on there that they know for sure that it's theirs. Bring a water bottle. Yes?
You said bring a camera, so can I use my smartphone as a camera?
We're going to talk about phones in a little bit. That's a good question. So with water bottles, try to send something that's not too big. We do have water stations throughout the camp, and the kids have to carry it. So something moderately sized, maybe even something like this size, because they don't want to carry it and they'll just leave it back if it's too much trouble. So definitely a water bottle. It can get really hot, and there are some parts of camp where they may be out doing archery and there's no shade there, or walking to the pond from the regular, like, general camp area to where the pond is. It's just like a quarter of a mile, so it's a little bit of a walk down there. So they definitely need to bring a water bottle. They can bring a camera. They don't have to, but they like to bring a camera. Towels are very important. Lots of kids forget towels. I don't know why. But consider sending two towels, one for pond and one for showering. The pond gets pretty pondish, kind of slimy. And so I think it's much cleaner to have a towel just for showering, but it's up to your kids. Sunblock and bug repellent. This is always an issue because a lot of kids do not want to put that on their skin. They don't like the smell. They don't like the feel, the texture of it. So there are a few solutions. If absolutely they will not put it on, we keep them in the shade, which is, it's difficult because then they're not fully participating. Sunblock, there are a lot of good powders now that you can use. They don't smell. They're a little harder to tell if you've got them on really well, but they do work really well with zinc oxide powders, and you can find them at the pharmacy or really anywhere. And then the same with bug repellent. Bug repellent, the kids don't need all the time, but every once in a while there are really bad mosquitoes, especially there's a fire pit area where we go, and there's some water kind of behind it. So if sometimes it's really bad, and if so, we'll save the kids. We need to use bug repellent because we're going to this area. And what a lot of kids do is they buy the little bracelets or the little things that clip on your belt so that they're not actually having to put it on their skin. They definitely can put it on their skin, but if they don't want to, either of those are good alternatives.
And for the sunblock, those UV rash guards work for arms and shoulders too.
Yeah. So definitely, I mean, we are going to be really cautious. Sometimes it's not as big of a deal, but we've had 90-degree weeks, and it's hot, and if they're burned, it makes it so much worse, and then everybody's uncomfortable. So we try really hard to make sure that they're sunscreening or that they're protected. You know, like a lot of kids do actually will wear like a sun hat or a rush or a sun guard shirt. Yeah, good point. So snacks are not allowed in the cabins, so don't pack them in their luggage. When you check in, all the food that you bring, if you bring any, will go to our kitchen. And we'll talk more about that when we get to the food area. Cell phone policy. So we do not allow cell phones at camp. I know that a lot of kids feel that this is their security item or that the item that they like to play games on. If your child or camper really, really depends on it, really is an issue, we ask you to suspend their service. So they can have the phone. There's no Wi-Fi there. Well, there's very, very, very spotty Wi-Fi, and it's really difficult to use. And what can happen is, and phone service too, but what can happen is the camper will decide to try to make a call, and you get like, hi, mom, you know, and then you have no idea what's happening, and then you're upset, and they're upset, and it's not good. We just don't want to even deal with having phone calls. If for some reason they need to make a phone call, they'll find me, and we'll make that phone call together. So if they really need their phone, then please suspend the service. But if not, you know, they can send other items to play with, and we'll talk about our video game policies in a little bit. Oops. What is that next? Okay, electronics policy. Okay, so we have several times throughout the day, well, one main time throughout the day we call it siesta, and after lunch we take a 2-hour downtime in the cabins, and it serves a lot of purposes, but during this time the campers can have their electronics. So we have them, when the campers come, they check their electronics in with the counselor, we put them in a locked box, and they're there. And then
in the cabin.
In the cabin, yeah, so right in the cabin, so it's just right there. The counselor's in charge of it. Then when it's siesta time, once everybody's ready for siesta, they'll check those back out to the campers, and they have a 2-hour window where they can play video games with their friends. Now, it's in-cabin time, so there's Uno games going on, and drawing, and all kinds of other things as well. Kids can bring other activities for this time. You know, sometimes kids will bring like Pokemon cards or other things that they like to do during this time, because it's just basically a downtime with your friends. But we do allow electronics during this time. And it ends up actually being quite a social opportunity for them, because they tend to kind of link up and play together, and they figure out ways that, oh, you have the same game I have, and then you'll find 5 or 6 kids sitting in a circle all talking and playing together. During this time, our counselors actually go on break, so anyone who's not a cabin counselor comes in. We also have day volunteers that come in, and we staff that with other people who aren't their typical counselors, so the counselors can have a break during the day. And then after that, they go straight into afternoon activities. So just some of the policies around this. We do not allow any M-rated games for any age, just because every family has different standards, and we just feel like it's not a place to expose their kids to things that they might not have at home. So we don't allow M-rated games or very violent things. They're only accessed during specific times. And then this is another place where you need to make sure that you label everything. Now, my son, he's like, we're not labeling my games. I don't want to put... And so this is where we put the little black dot in the corner of each game so that he knew it was his. And so he could identify. Because a lot of times it'll just, you know, a game will just get sat down. And someone's like, well, I also have that game. And they don't know exactly whose it is. So the video game stuff is really important, that they label their games.
And their chargers and their charging blocks, because the counselors make sure we do our best to keep their electronics charged, and we don't know one charger for the next.
Because it all goes into the same toolbox, doesn't it?
It's really helpful when they're marked.
Yeah, anything you send, you can charge it. It's fantastic. Yes?
What systems do you have, like gaming systems?
So it's only handhelds. So we don't have any systems, but you can bring DS and iPad. Some kids bring their Kindle, PlayStation Portable, it's called PSPs.
No. iPods.
I learned about it at camp.
Music.
iPods, you know, mostly that kind of stuff is what's going to be available. Whatever you bring. Not everyone brings electronics, so don't feel like you know, pressured if your child isn't into electronics, they don't need to bring it. And they certainly will have plenty of things to do without it. But it's just a time for them if they do want it. And we have no internet connection, so. Okay. Mail. So if you would like to send mail or a package for your camper, you can mail it. And the address is in the packet that I sent you. You can also drop it off when you check in before the barbecue and label it when you would like it to be delivered. So just put the date, the day, and we'll deliver those to them on the day. Typically, you know, a letter from home, maybe it's something to play with during siesta time. Those are the types of things. Don't send food, though, because the camp is very strict about not having food in the cabins. And so we keep all the food in the kitchen. They have mice. And so we know this because there's some food in the cabins. So they just, that's just a rule. So we keep all the food in the kitchen. Let's see. So in the packet I sent you on the very back page, there is a little description and picture of a bunk sign. So when we check in, what happens is you can go with your camper to their cabin, put all their stuff away, and then they're going to hang up a bunk sign that they've brought. This is a really good way for kids to start conversations. So they're going to put on their bunk sign something that they like, some stuff about themselves. So then what happens is the counselors can come in or the other campers and be like, oh, you like Pokemon? I know this about it, you know, and it just sparks all these conversations actually throughout the week with the kids. So, and plus it kind of labels, this is my area, all my stuff is gonna be right here. So it's important that they do that at check-in. Yep, and there's sort of all of that stuff. Are you saying anything?
Maybe I'll assess them.
Okay, what else? Oh, this is a good one. Okay, so.
That's why I let you say it.
Yeah, the swim test can be a little bit stressful. So they require that you can swim on top of the water from one side of the pool to the other and back. So if you're swimming like this, they won't pass you. You have to be on top of the water. So
it's width.
Yeah, not width. Length. Yeah, not the long width, but width and back. So basically, and then they have you tread water for 1 minute. What happens if you don't pass the swim test is they will give you a life jacket. So
if you want to go in the deep end.
Yeah, if you don't want to go in the deep end, you can stay in the shallow end and you don't have to pass the swim test. But if you want to go in the deep end, you'll have to wear a life jacket if you don't pass the swim test. So please make sure you talk to your campers about this. This can be a really stressful situation for them if they don't pass. And actually what the camp has been fantastic. They really try to work it out with our kids, and they'll do another swim test if they want to try again. They'll do it the next day. We've started the last few years, we do it sort of in really small groups, so it's not like everyone's watching. So they'll just take a couple kids at a time. They'll go down and do the swim test. And then once you've passed, you've passed. So even if you passed last year, they'll count it for us. So they're really good about it. But the alternative is the life jacket. So that's something that the kids need to know about. Yes?
Can you bring our own life jacket as long as it's Coast Guard?
Yes. And actually, so the life jackets we have, they're from the pond. And they tend to not be like the freshest life jackets. So, my first couple of years, I sent a life jacket with my son. Yeah.
What if your kid wants nothing to do with the pool?
They don't have to go in the pool. It's an optional thing that we have in the afternoons, and we have a lot of different things going on. So they may never go in the pool or the pond. Yeah.
So if you know that they cannot pass the swim test, can they just not take it?
Yes. Mm-hmm. Yeah, they don't have to take it. It's only if they want to try to go to the deep end.
Okay. But if they're like, oh, I want to go in the pool, but I just want to like jump.
Uh-huh. Yep, that's totally fine.
Or they want to stay in the shallow end.
That's yeah. Perfect.
And you have to wear a life jacket in the pond, correct? Is that the rule?
Yes, everyone wears a life jacket in the pond. So adults and everyone. So if you're going canoeing or fishing on the bank, they want everyone at the pond in a life jacket. So yeah, that's something good to prepare them for too. You want to talk about big canoes?
I can.
Okay.
So the staff in the kitchen, they are amazing. So that's an important thing to know. And they know our campers, and they know that not all of our campers like everything they serve. so they are very flexible. But it's really helpful if you review the menu in advance. Do they get a sample menu yet?
I haven't sent the menu because I'm going to send the finalized one. So it should come out before camp.
So you should review it, and then you can decide what your camper will eat or not eat, and you can send an alternative. And what happens is when they get to the in the cafeteria, there's a window where we all get food. There's a little door right before, so they just go to the door and look for Jane, and Jane is very discreet and meets them and works with them to figure out what they're going to eat for that meal if they don't want to eat what's being served. So it's important that all food is labeled. Just like all the other labels that we've asked for, and that we want to talk about.
What Jane does is, so when you turn in, so some kids are on completely separate diets. And if they've gotten really good about, they can do gluten-free now. So we used to have a lot of kids on gluten-free that had to pack their own meals. But if you're going to pack your own meals for something, you turn in the menu and you write on there what meal it's going to be. So she'll prepare it ahead of time. So when they get to the door, it's warmed up and she just hands it straight to them. They don't have to wait. So she can't prepare anything. She can just warm it up. So that's the only thing that she can really do. Or if it's something that's cold, she can just give it to them cold. But she's very efficient about it as long as you communicate that with her. And she will also be there at check-in, so you can go over any dietary or menu issues with her at that time. Yeah.
So when you say warm up whole menu, should she make groceries by except the bread and cheese?
I don't think so. I think it's just basically warm. I mean, we can ask her.
Cheese from their own, right? I feel like some of my campers, that's been an alternative that she's offered from her kitchen, but
okay. Let's ask.
Okay.
Typically, I just say she's going to make it. We've had situations where people send like ingredients, and then she was like, I don't have time to prepare all these things and get, you know, we have about, I don't know, 250 people that she's trying to feed all at the same time.
Maybe it's a hot dog.
Yeah, but we can definitely ask. So if you are on a special diet, there's a special diet form that I emailed out to you, and we need to get that back so we can get to them ahead of time. So if you're lactose intolerant or you're allergic to something specific, she will keep all of that information, and she's very good about keeping track and making sure that your child eats. The other thing is, she makes sure the kids eat. She's fantastic. She watches to see if kids are not eating, and she'll come to us and say, you know what, that kid didn't eat breakfast, and I saw them just not eat their lunch either. And so then we check in with them, we, you know, figure out what the problem is, and we solve it. So, I mean, one time we had a kid who wasn't eating, his stomach was really upset, and, you know, she just started giving him Go-Gurts. You know, she's like, well, he's just going to eat Go-Gurts. And I mean, they worked it out, but she's really good about, she's very vigilant about making sure that everyone's fed. It's like her mission in life to make sure that everyone is fed.
She's successful.
And the food is so good. Like, we did another camp another time at a different facility, and I think the main difference was the food. So, I mean, the food that we have is so good.
And I feel like we eat all day long.
Yeah, me too. All the walking
we have
you do,
two snacks in addition to three meals, so.
Yeah, every year at camp, I'm like, oh, I'm exhausted. I've been walking and exercising the entire week, and I always gain weight. Because you just eat so much food. Yeah, so we have three meals plus snacks throughout the day. So if the kids are hungry, we will figure out a snack for them. You can also bring snacks when you check in, and you can check those into the kitchen. So if there's something particular that they like, they can say, you know, I'm really needing my own snack. And their counselor can walk into the kitchen, and they can have that snack, and then they can return to the kitchen.
And also feel free when you check in and meet the counselors in your camper's cabin to talk to us about concerns you have about food. And we sit at the tables with the campers, so we, you know, we keep an eye out on them for that too. So.
Oh yeah. And the other thing is, when you pick them up, a lot of people pick up all the food that you sent. I mean, it's nice to have it there as a safety net, but the kids are hungry because they are walking and playing and busy all day, and the food smells so good, and everyone else is eating it, so they eat a lot of different things that they normally don't eat. And the food is good. Okay, so once during the week, we're going to have camp store. So we've changed what we're doing with Camp Store. We used to say send up to $25, but in the Camp Store, all that's really there is we rent the facility that we go to is called Camp Tapawingo, and they have Camp Tapawingo items in the store, like hats and shirts and stuff. That will be open at drop-off and pickup, but we're not going to have that available to the kids. So when they go to the store, they're just going to get an ice cream and a soda or a candy bar. It's just a fun time for their cabin to go and purchase a sweet treat. We don't do a lot of sweets, and so it's just kind of a special time for them to go with their group. So $5 is plenty. They'll be able to get whatever it is they want to eat at that. We have popcorn, ice cream sandwiches, just general stuff like that. And then it's always a lot of, so what happens is when we were doing it at $20, I would try to find everyone when they picked up their kids, and then I'd end up with like five envelopes that had people's money left over from the store that they didn't spend, and it ends up being a lot of work. So we're just going to not return it. We're just going to put it, if they don't use the full $5, we're going to just add it to our camp. So hopefully that's okay with everyone. And we will also have Camp Otakota items for sale at drop-off and pickup, but not throughout the week. Let's see. Oh, yeah, that's what they include. Okay, so tips. What are they, Amy?
Oh, look at that picture.
Oh, there's Amy.
We have a great talent show. That's from the talent show. So, tips about preparing your camper. Self-care. So, we are in cabins in kind of close proximity to each other. So self-care gets quite important because, you know, they're a little closed in cabins, so they can get kind of smelly. I stay in a boys' cabin, and I have girls at home, so there's a different element that I guess I've become used to. So it's important to prepare your camper for showering. We, in general, don't make the camper shower every day. Some of our campers like to shower every day. Most cabins do have a rule that if you've been in the pond, you have to shower because the pond is pond water. So if you could prepare your camper for showering, and brushing teeth and applying sunscreen and bug repellent too. So all the things around self-care, just to let them know that there will be some rules around it. And I know in our cabin, we just come up with a plan at the beginning of the week. We ask each camper, okay, what's your showering like? Do you like to shower every day? Do you like the morning? Do you like the night? What's your plan? So we just sort of plan it and talk about they have to shower like at least once while they're there, I think is our general rule.
Well, I have to say, my son has come home with his entire suitcase packed the exact way that I sent him. So, I mean, we're not going to get in the power struggle.
No,
we're going to try our best to keep it clean and scrub it when they get home.
And I think you talked about, too, if they don't like showering, baby wipes or whatever, or, you know, bird baths come in handy.
Yeah. So the way that it works, the cabins are all different, but like in the one Amy stays in, they actually have an individual little bathroom room that closes, right? There's a door. Mm-hmm. But in some of the other ones, it's there'll be four bedrooms in one cabin building, and they have showers with curtains in there. And then for the yurts, they have to come down to the pool house to shower because they don't actually have bathrooms up there. So it's a little different for each cabin the way it works. But it's private, and generally when it's shower time, they're sending one kid in at a time, and the counselors are kind of just monitoring that. The other thing to mention to them is a lot of times we find that our kids are either over-modest or under-modest. So just discussing with them about, you know, what's going to happen when they come out of the shower. Just kind of generally being aware of modesty. Like Amy said, we do have female counselors that stay in our cabins with the boys. We have about three boys to every one girl, and so it's probably the opposite for counselors. So we have, in the boy cabins, we have a male counselor in each room, and then we fill in the rest with female counselors. So.
Yeah, so when it's like shower time, Jimmy and I are often in the same cabin, so I leave the room and the door shut, and Jimmy tells me when it's safe for me to come back in so that we keep that all private for the campers.
Yeah.
And for me.
Yeah. Okay.
So other things are just, we find that campers are often most successful when they have an idea of what to expect, of what's going to happen for new campers. So to share the menu and talk about the schedule we always try to prepare them. What we actually, the cabins write the schedule down every day, so they know what's going to happen, what's going to be different about today, or what's going to be the same. We keep the food menu up so they know what's for meals that day. But it's good to kind of give them an idea of expectations. There we have, I don't even know how many clubs we're going to have this year.
Yeah, generally maybe around 10 clubs. Yeah.
What we ask the campers, so we have a lot of clubs, usually in the morning we have club time. So what do we have? We have a water club, a science club.
Drama.
Science.
Yeah.
We're going to do archery and adventure.
Are we still going to have LARPing and bothering again?
Yes.
So we have a lot, there's something for everyone, I think. And what we ask the campers to do when they check in is to sign up for their top three clubs that they would like to be in. And we work really hard to try to get all of them their first choice if we can. We want to make sure everybody has fun, so we make sure if they don't get their first choice, we find a way to work it out, because having fun is the most important part. But it's good to look at those descriptions in advance so that when you check in and we say, okay, what's your first choice, that your camper has an idea of what it is.
And they'll stay with that club for the whole week. So every morning they'll go to that same group. And the reason we do it that way is because they can get a much more in-depth thing, experience with the thing that they like the most. So like for our fine art club, we're gonna have a local artist who's gonna come out and teach a day about ribbon drawing, and she's gonna work with the kids on that day. And then we'll have some other special guests or professionals that come during those times. So it's just a more in-depth experience for them. The afternoon is not like that. They can come and go, they can go to any activity. So for example, if they sign up for art in the morning, but they're like, oh, I really want to go to the pond, they go to the pond in the afternoon. So it's not, they don't have to just exclusively do that thing. They can choose most of the things. A lot of the things that happen in the morning will also happen in the afternoon. Not all of them, but we make the kids aware of which ones will not be happening so that they can choose wisely.
There's a list of the clubs later on the slide, sorry.
Oh.
Other expectations. Camp is a no teasing zone. And we do take this very seriously because not everyone interprets teasing in the same way. So I know you're looking at me. I'm a teaser by nature, so I have to work really hard at camp to inhibit my teasing. But not everyone takes it the same way, and so some people get hurt feelings. So we just have a blanket policy, no teasing. We want everyone to have fun. So, I'm just looking. How do you want to work, describe that? Next line, just even if some are annoying to another camper.
So, I mean, the thing about autism is, you know, pretty strong personalities, and sometimes that means they're strong in the same way and they're just drawn to the friendships, but sometimes it's the opposite. And so we work really hard. We spend a lot of time placing kids in cabins. We look at the profile of every kid. We look at all the information you've sent us, and we match the kids with who we think might be a good friend for them. And then we do the same thing with our counselors. We look at the strengths of our counselors and the needs of our kids, and we try to match them. It's a big process, but I think it really makes the experience a lot more successful. But there are going to be kids who annoy each other and kids, you know, who are getting irritated, but we work it out. And I think we have so many adults. We have two kids to one adult. So we always have an adult there. The kids are never going to, they're never going to have like a full-out argument without somebody hearing, because they're going to be right there. So we do a lot of preventative. If we see something coming or we see a situation getting a little bit heated, you know, we'll offer to take the kids. Hey, you want to go for a walk? That's our first line of defense. If it looks like it's not just going to be something that's going to go away, is we kind of separate, we take a break, go for a little walk, come back, maybe talk about it on the walk, maybe not, depending on how the camper's feeling, and then come back in and try again. So it works out.
Mm-hmm. It always does. Mm-hmm. I find, it always does. So we also have a zero tolerance for threatening language or threatening actions. So if anyone talks about hurting someone else or hurting themselves, we definitely intervene. And any camper who displays violent behavior, we sit home. Unless it's in boffering.
Okay, so if you don't know what boffering is, it's they make foam swords and shields and all this other stuff. And we have a buffering specialist who's coming out, who's fantastic, and he will lead it. And it's very structured, and so there's all these rules of battle. And it sounds crazy, but it works. They get out there and they have these big battles and they follow the rules and they have a very, very fun time. So just to comment sort of about this though. So, you know, we definitely, if something happens that we feel is something that's beyond what we should be seeing, we'll call you. And we will make a plan immediately on how we're going to deal with that. And it's very, very rare that we ever have to send a camper home. Maybe 4 times ever. We will work it out. Generally, the campers want to be there and they want to succeed at camp. And so we may assign them a one-on-one counselor. We may write a contract with them and hold them to it, have them sign it and refer back to it. There's a lot of different things that will happen before it's just like, boom. But if it's something big that we don't feel like they can be safe at camp or that they can be safe for themselves or other kids, that's when it would be we would need you to come get them. We will be reviewing all the camper files, like I just said, to place kids, but also we write up kind of a bio of every kid that we give to the counselors, and this is from the information you've provided with your application. Your teachers provided, your schools, your IEPs, anything that you gave us, we will make a sort of a one sheet, information sheet that will go out to the cabin counselors so that they're prepared for what it is your camper loves to do and what it is that's hard for them so that they can be ready to intervene if they see things coming. And a lot of times, it ends up like, oh yeah, I know this kid really doesn't like noise, and this other kid's noisy. I'm going to take them over. I'm going to put them in this group instead of this group. Just stuff like that. Where
or somebody loves bugs and insects, and somebody else is really afraid of them.
Yeah.
We sweep the cabin before they get there and pay attention to that.
Yeah.
Try to keep them happy. That's just been an issue in our cabin. So.
Yeah. So if we see something that we feel like your camper may have a hard time, we may just contact you ahead of time and just ask you for some suggestions, make a plan, maybe talk to your camper on the phone. If you feel yourself that that is needed, feel free to call us maybe a couple weeks before camp and just say, hey, this has changed since I applied, or he's really feeling anxious about this, and I can connect you with either someone in their cabin or Corinne and I will make a plan with them to make sure they're successful. Generally, I mean, there are some kids that have a little bit of a hard time. A lot. I would say the majority of our kids have never stayed away from home except for with family when they first came to camp. So sometimes that initial saying goodbye can be hard for new campers, but once we've got them, usually they kind of snap out of that and they do fine. Yeah, so fun. We have the lizard. I need to schedule that. The reptile guy, he's been coming the last few years and he's fantastic. Just lets the kids teaches them all about all the reptiles and lets them hold them. Okay, questions? Any questions? Yes.
Yeah. How many campers are in the camp? And then what is the breakup between like the older kids and the younger kids like this year? Like
So good question. So we have 85 campers and the yurts can only hold 30 campers. Mm-hmm. So we move the oldest 30 kids basically. It's not always exactly just the oldest because it's also, we take into account the more independent, that the yurt program's a little more independent and they take a trip to the beach and they have less counselor support than the younger kids. So, but generally it's the older kids, 30 in the upper program and the rest are in the, I say upper because it's up the hill.
Okay.
So, and then the rest are in the cabin program.
It's about 30 kids in the upper.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. And do they get a chance to like meet each other beforehand, like other
barbecue?
I don't know, social events like before the camp starts? Are they all just meeting each other for the first time?
Yeah, I mean, generally we don't have anything ahead of time. I'm actually thinking about doing something this summer because we're starting an endowment for Camp La Dakota, and when we hand over that check, I kind of wanted to do like a barbecue or something so that we can invite everyone to come. But who knows if I'll get to it, but generally they're meeting for the first time. But we have probably, I don't know, 55, 60 returning kids.
Okay.
So, I mean, basically a lot of the kids are veterans. They'll meet, I mean, really the kids right away, it helps with the bunk signs because right away they see other kids who are interested in things they're interested in, and they also know, oh, they're in my cabin, they can come with me, you know, so they really, they pretty much intermingle from the very beginning. Would you agree?
Mm-hmm.
Any other questions?
How many kids typically in each cabin?
So the cabins are all different sizes. So the one that Amy's in, we call it, it's called Mountain View, the big house. they have 12 campers in that cabin, and it's just basically two bedrooms. And then the girls, the younger program girls, they have two very small cabins that only hold about 6 or 7 each. And then there's two larger groups for the younger program that have 4 bedrooms, and one will have about 14 kids, and the other have about 18 kids. And then the yurts have 5 in each yurt. Sometimes 6. I'll throw a cot in there if you have an extra kid, because I have a hard time saying no. Any other questions? Anything else I didn't cover? Oh, there's more? Oh, okay.
Yeah. There's
more. Okay, what to expect at check-in?
Those pictures are great.
Okay, so like I said, we arrive at 4, you're gonna drop off all your stuff. Oh, another thing to mention to the kids is that they're gonna do a lice check. So when you go through the check-in process, you'll sign up for your clubs, you'll get your camp t-shirt. We won't actually hand it to you, but we'll have you write their name in the collar, and so that it's that size is assigned to them, and then we'll disperse those. And on the last day when we do our picture, we'll have the kids wear their shirts so we can do it in the picture, and they're still clean. And you'll deposit your store money, you'll see the nurse, you'll do a lice check, you'll meet Jane at the kitchen, and then this is a great time for you to talk with your counselor. So if anything's changed, or you want them to know something, or if you're feeling anxious about something, or they're feeling anxious about something, this is a great time to check in with the people who are going to be with your kids throughout the week. The barbecue will be at 5:30. I don't need you to sign up in advance, I'm just going to estimate, but we will pay for the camper we'll pay for whoever comes, but you can consider if you're bringing multiple people to make a donation. That's how much they charge us for the meal. For each person is $7, so that's up to you. We would not want you to not stay for the barbecue because you felt like you're obligated to pay. It's an important time for you and for your campers to feel comfortable before it's time to go. After dinner, we say, okay, counselors, grab your campers, and at that time, we all leave at the same time, so the campers all go back to their cabins, and the parents all say goodbye and go, so it's a pretty good break. It usually works pretty good. I mean, sometimes there's one or two kids that are lingering, not wanting the parents to go, and sometimes there's a lot of parents lingering, not wanting their kids to go, but usually after the first few minutes, then it all settles down, and the first night is a little bit more chaotic than the first nights, just because everyone's trying to figure out their place at camp and what it's all about. And then by the next morning, everything just calms down and they just get into a group. Emergency contact. So some people take vacations while their kids are at camp, which is perfectly fine. If you are going to do that, make sure that you have that you give us your information. So whatever contact information it is, that if something goes wrong at camp, that we can contact you. Our camp nurse will respond to any medical emergencies. Now, if they get stung by a bee, or every once in a while someone will fall off the blob. Do you guys? I haven't talked about the blob, have I? Did you see the picture? So the blob is.
There hasn't been a picture of the blob yet.
A giant pillow that sits out on the pond, and you jump off a platform, you crawl out to the end, and then someone else jumps and it catapults you into the pond.
We don't make anyone do that.
No, I've done it once, and that was plenty for me. But sometimes
never done it.
You haven't?
And I may never do it.
I haven't either.
It's scary to jump off the platform, I think, but the kids, they do it just fine. But sometimes they'll fall on the deck, and they'll get a scrape. We're not going to call you for stuff like that, but unless they're in pain and they really want to talk to you, but we're going to manage those little things, because a lot of times calling causes homesick. So we're going to do our best to manage everything at camp. And even if they come to me at dinner and say, I really want to call, I'm going to say to them, hey, is there any way we can wait until morning? Can we finish out the evening and call? Because I really try to do phone calls in the morning because kids are less tired and less emotional. And so sometimes they just want to check in with their parents, and that'll pull them through. But calling at night sometimes can be upsetting to them and to you. So that's kind of how we'll handle that. Yeah, and we will call a lot. Sometimes if I think maybe they're hurt, or if I'm not sure, are they overreactors or are they really hurting, I'll just call you, not with them, but I'll just call and say, hey, this is what happened. They're acting this way. Is that typical for them? And just get some advice on how to move forward. We know that our campers can have difficulties, and we do a lot of accommodating and a lot of preventative things that help them be successful. Just having so many adults is one thing. I mean, that really is our key line of defense, is just the adults are always there. We have 85 campers. We have day volunteers that come for the day, and so even though we have about 45 cabin counselors, we usually have at least 5 outside of the cabin adults, and then during the day we'll get about 10 adults that come for the day and volunteer. So we have a lot of adults all the time. We already talked about that. It is our goal that everyone has fun. That's our biggest goal, is that we want every camper to make a friend, to feel more confident, and to have fun. And so we do that. Our visual schedules, our expectations, we use the 5-point scale. We make everything as predictable as possible so that they can fully prepare themselves for what's coming next and avoid any kind of stress. And it's funny, we get a lot of volunteers, even people who work with kids on the spectrum, they'll come and like, are you sure that kids on the spectrum? Are you sure? And it's because of the structure and how comfortable the kids are that you may not see any of their symptoms coming out, because they're so comfortable and confident that it's not stressful for them. And so what we always say is that, you know, in society, we make our kids fit into a different mold. We're expecting them to always fit into what we want, but at camp, we fit into their mold, and we try to make everything about what they need. And so it just changes their level of functioning, really.
And if I can just add to that, we don't force anything. So, and I know some of the campers I've worked with, we have one camper who noise really upsets him. He never wants to eat in the cafeteria. We know that. He likes to eat outside. So we just have a plan. We see him, we go sit outside with him. We never say, oh no, you have to eat inside. That's, you know, whatever we can do to accommodate, I mean, within reason, but there always is a reason. If you don't want to sit by the rest of the, during the talent show, it can be too noisy for some kids to sit there. So we go and sit on the side with them. So that's easy. I know we've had another camper who eats very quickly and then likes to walk around in the cafeteria. So things that you might not be able to do at another camp or in school or somewhere else, fine with us, you know, as long as it's not harmful.
Yeah, what I also love is the kids. They all look out for each other, and they get it. So, like, I'll get, excuse me, Misty, he's going to the pool to have a meltdown, you know, and I may not see it, but they see it. They're friends, you know, and so, I remember one time my son had a really hard time with food. I think he was probably maybe like 11 or 12, and he got a different breakfast than everyone else, and someone else said, why do you get a different breakfast? And another kid just goes, none of your business, he probably needs that. And just like, totally, like, you know, diffused it all, and my son was kind of embarrassed until that, and he was like, okay, they get it, you know? So, I mean, the kids understand, and they have the language, because we've all taught them, you know, about meltdowns and all these other things, and so they're looking out for each other, which, you know, sometimes that's just the key, is the peers, the peer environment really makes them successful. They're pretty sweet campers.
Yeah.
I mean, really, there is not one camper I would say is just naughty. They aren't naughty. They're good kids who want to please and want to have fun, and we get to enjoy them, and they get to enjoy camp.
And they're also really kind. Like, if there is, I mean, there's always a little altercation. You're with kids, and they're so apologetic to each other and so kind. That's why I keep coming back, because it just gives me hope about the world in general to hang out at camp for a week, to be honest.
That's awesome.
I think you
talked about that, yeah. So we do a training with our counselors, just so you know. I mean, we take all different types of people who from all different walks of life. Some of our campers work with kids. I mean, we get doctors and speech paths and all kinds of people who work with kids with autism. But we also just get a random person who are our neighbors. We get a lot of our neighbors who come, or you know, people from our church, and it's just people. But everyone comes in the day before. We do a training with them. We do a lot of coaching with, like, how to work with kids with autism, but also we have a lot of returning counselors. So probably well over half of our counselors return year to year. So they're mentoring the new counselors to make sure that we're all kind of running the program the same way. And I think our key, the last line, our key to counselors, when people say, well, I don't know anything about it, I'm like, the key to being successful at camp is that you're kind and patient. Because really that's all the kids want. If you're kind to them and patient with them, you will be successful.
And we also have built-in support with breaks and whatnot. Because sometimes we do get tired, and it's hard to be patient when we're tired. But we get breaks, so we can go get some time to ourselves.
Okay, so these are the clubs for me. Oh no, these are the ones so far. Although computer programming I'm still working on. I'm not sure if we'll be able to have that one because our person hasn't committed. But these are a general idea. A couple weeks before camp, I will send you out the menu, the clubs, everything that you need to make sure you talk about prior to check-in. But those are generally what we do. If nature's hiking, we have a lot of fun. Drama is very popular. Amy leads that one. We didn't really talk about the talent show. The talent show is the best night of camp. It's the last night, and basically the kids, they can do any talent they want. So we've had kids spit M&Ms. Like as far as they could. And you know, they spit the M&M and the crowd goes wild. And it's like stuff that you really can't do at a school talent show, but you feel like you're good at it, you know? We had a kid last year who stood up and was like, yes, I would like to recite the first 55 digits of pi. And he did it. And it was like, awesome. And everyone just went wild. It was so cool. But we've got singing and dancing and skits and, you know, all
joke
kinds
telling.
Of jokes. Comedy, I mean, puppetry, anything you can think of. My son used to do the pogo stick every year. He would pogo stick around. He doesn't do it anymore. But just whatever you can think of. And the thing about the talent show is the kids are so supportive, and they just enjoy each other doing whatever it is that they do. So that's all of our favorite night at camp, is to be able to see the kids just in their element.
Quick question.
Yeah.
On fishing, you guys supply all the gear?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. If they have something special that they would like to bring, we have had kids bring their own pole in the past. They can, and we'll just keep it at the pond and mark it, make sure it's marked with their name. But usually, Rob right there, he usually kind of organizes it all and gets power bait. And it's a stock pond, so they usually catch quite a few fish. Yeah, and it's catch and release, although they don't always survive.
And some of them like to just catch the salamanders.
Oh yeah, there's lots of salamanders there. We have nets and stuff so the kids can just kind of play in the water. And
there's canoes.
They're not wearing life jackets, but they should be.
Yes, trust us with the
But yeah, so the kids, I mean, everyone's in a life jacket, so they can walk all the way out to the pond. They can canoe by themselves. They don't have to have an adult. They can take an adult. They can play in the water and catch salamanders. The pond is pretty, it's a pretty neat.
And there are lifeguards on duty at the pond and the pool, so.
Oh yeah, yeah. That's
important. Yeah, that is important.
Okay, just the last one.
There's just the other, just the going on after this.
Okay, let's go through those and then we'll take the next question.
This is such a great picture though.
It is. Okay, is there any more information?
Yeah.
Okay, good. On Saturday morning, they'll be ready at 10 o'clock. So basically on Saturday, all we do is get up, have breakfast, say goodbyes, take some photos. There's no real programming that morning. So they'll be ready at 10 o'clock. Try your best to ride on time because they are going to be excited to see you. And when you arrive, we'll have you go to the cabin and pick them up. We don't do any kind of big ceremony at the end, just you will go to the cabin and pick them up, check out with their counselor. Make sure you pick up any food or medications that you dropped off. If you arrive early, we would like to suggest that you help us clean up. We have a lot of things to clean in the morning.
I think that's really, you're really selling it.
It's a fantastic opportunity for you to participate in camp. That we vacuuming and loading of cars and that kind of stuff that happens in the morning. So the reason I say that too is because a lot of times that's a kind of a special goodbye time with the camper. So if you come at 9, they might miss some of that, you know, saying goodbye and taking cabin photos and stuff. So if you arrive at 9, we may ask you to either sit in your car so we don't know you're there, or we may ask you to work. We do not allow visitors at camp, well, volunteers, but not family visitors or any of that, because it's just hard on the kids. We have actually had a couple times where we've had some volunteers who are parents, and actually myself being there with my son, sometimes it upsets the other kids because they'll see him come and talk to me and they're like, oh, I miss my mom, you know. So it's really better just to not have any families at camp. And plus we don't background check families, so that, you know, having all of our volunteers at background check, and so we there's no volunteers. Payments are due by August 1st. That's the final, that's really when I need the payments by to meet our budget. If you need a payment plan beyond that, you can feel free to talk to me about it and we can work something out. But if not, that's kind of on my deadline. It's harder for the parents. I mean, I think it is, especially because you don't know during the week what's happening. Oh, I didn't talk about Facebook. If you haven't friended us on Facebook, friend the camp on Facebook prior to camp. So if you do it that day, it'll probably take me 24 hours to accept it, but we post all of our pictures throughout the week on Facebook. So it's a huge commitment on our part. We have to sit in the janitor's closet plugged into the modem.
So slow.
But we will try our best to upload as many pictures as we can so that you can see what's going on at camp. And it's very encouraging for us, for our counselors and stuff, to see when you're getting those pictures and you're excited and you're saying nice comments. It's encouraging to our counselors to see them.
Can't see until we get home because we don't have internet connection.
Yeah. Some of us see it, make sure that you prepare your camper a few weeks ahead of time. Like I said, I'll be sending out some more specific information in that time, making sure you go through all of the stuff with them. We've never met a camper who didn't have fun at camp, so I'm sure your child's not going to be the first one. We do a lot of fun things. We will challenge them to do things that are outside of their comfort zone, but we will also support them in that so that they are comfortable. We're not going to get into a lot of, we're going to pick our battles pretty reasonably. Let's see. Okay, yeah, that's all just general stuff you can read. So we try to, in the end, we try to send out a camper contact list. So sometimes I forget to do it, but you always email me. But when you signed up, you checked whether you were okay with that or not. So just so the kids can get in touch with each other. A lot of our campers do hang out throughout the year outside of camp. I mean, they're really some, my son, I mean, the same kids have been coming for 8 years. And so he has a whole group of friends that they're all friends on Tumblr and everywhere else, and they get together, you know, periodically. So we'll try to provide that information for you. So, okay, questions? Perfect. Yes.
Do you know if there's any concerns about availability of lodging on pickup day, or I guess weekend, pickup day, because of the solar eclipse?
Yeah, they don't rent out the facility to small groups.
Oh yeah, if they head out of Southern Oregon super early just so I can get to the camp by 10 o'clock in the morning.
Yeah, I don't. You know, they on the Camp Capitolino website, they have like campgrounds and stuff, but I have a feeling a lot of that stuff is pretty full already.
I gathered about everything along the path of the eclipse.
Yeah, we may. Actually, that's a good thing to bring up. They're expecting a lot of traffic delays, and I don't know how that's going to affect us on Saturday. So, you know, just know if you are arriving late to camp, we will not leave your camper. Their counselor will sit with them. We will make it as fun as possible, and we'll explain to them, you know, that it's traffic.
It's over there, you take a right and then another right. The main lobby,
so I've heard some reports that there's like going to be 2 to 3 hour traffic delays headed towards the beach. Let's hope that's not the case coming to into Dallas, but it is something to kind of watch ahead of time to see what the news is saying about that.
Yeah, I'm coming the night before and staying somewhere nearby, but I'm not sure that we're doing it.
Yeah, I don't know how safe
it's going to be.
Yeah, well, I don't know. I think so. Because Oregon State's renting out their dorms, and yes, maybe a lot of people. Any other questions? Yes.
I'm wondering about how much I'm going to carry this stuff around. Maybe question I want to know would be more helpful: a double bag suitcase or a Pullman suitcase?
It really doesn't matter. I mean, it's a gravel road from where you drop off up to the cabin, but we'll help. Well, our counselors will be there to help you carry your stuff. So
I just want him to be as independent as he can with his own, watching out for his own stuff. But if it's too heavy, you know, and of course if it's not paved and wheels aren't so good, you kind of get what.
People bring both, and they're able to roll their suitcases. I mean, they might get scraped up from the gravel, but
everything is already scraped up.
So. Yeah, so but, I mean, it works both ways.
And every cabin's different, sort of, about where there's room for luggage. So
I'm just worried about him carrying his own bag.
Well, we counselors usually carry it for them to get in and out of the cabin, so.
And then from there, it'll just be in the cabin. The only thing they really take with them is their water bottle.
Okay. Well, I mean, like, two of them in the car.
Yeah.
Just, the, you know, whatever, you know.
Yeah, so when at drop-off, the counselors will all be waiting to meet you, and then they'll grab everybody's stuff.
Oh,
and so
okay.
Yeah.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah, they'll help you carry it up, and they'll show you where to go and stuff. Any other questions?
Yeah. Getting back to that blob thing, is there an opportunity for parents?
I love this stuff. They're so strict with that.
Here, you keep talking.
I'm trying to think where
it's
on the website. It's in the video.
Yeah, I know where it is.
Yeah, they only unlock the pond when there's a lifeguard, so. That's a good idea. We all, as counselors on our training day, we all try to go down there and have experience before the kids come.
So, did you hear to say each cabin has that bathroom and toilet inside?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, not the yurt. They have to use that through the house. But all the other cabins have bathrooms right in the cabins.
Okay.
So, one thing we didn't talk about was relationships between campers.
Yeah,
that comes
so
up a lot.
Sometimes because. You know, we have campers all the way up to 18 years old, so sometimes relationships do form, boy-girl relationships. And our philosophy is that, you know, it's typically developing behavior, but we do have some rules around physical contact and how that all can work. So, you know, we allow some hand-holding and some side hugs, but other than that, there is no other physical contact. And the kids are never alone, so that's another pretty significant piece of that, but some of our kids, you know, they'll date after camp, and you know, if they break up, it's not so fun the next year. But you know, it's typical for their age, and it's part of the experience.
So I was trying to find the pictures of the blog, and I'm not
okay.
Being successful.
They're public.
I know they're on here. I just don't know where.
Mm-hmm. I saw it on the.
There's a bunch on the video. Right? Yes.
I came in late, so I apologize if you already talked about this. The electronics, though, I was reading about this. So my son doesn't have any, like, handheld electronics. And is this a really common thing that people bring
last
them?
Last year.
What, if he doesn't have that, how is it, bring other things to do, or what?
He won't be the only one. Yeah, so there's a lot of kids who don't have, I mean, there's a lot of kids who really, that's, like, their comfort item, and then there's other kids who don't. So during the electronic times, we always have, like, Uno games and drawing, and we have some crafts that we throw in there, just independent crafts. But there's also just always a lot of adults to hang out with and talk to, and other kids to play with. And some kids bring like Pokemon cards, or some kids bring Lego, like a little set of Legos that they'll play with. So it's just whatever your camper enjoys to do. There's a 2-hour downtime when they're in the cabin, and that's usually when they have it.
Great, thank you. Yes, several of our campers didn't have devices. That's fine.
Yeah. It's not,
sometimes
it's
they can share too.
Yeah.
They'll share.
Okay.
I'm just just playing the video in the background. There, you can see the blob behind the John Luke there, but it was blurry, so it'll show up.
No.
You don't have to watch
that. That's Mr. Ed. He's been coming since the very first year.
I turned the sound off, so you can keep talking. There's other questions.
Yes. Asking questions, I'm sorry. So one of my kids was really interested. What's the current life?
Basically our day, we do morning clubs and then siesta. You know, the meals are all there. Then siesta, then afternoon activities. And then after dinner, we do our evening program.
Sorry, there's a lot.
So during evening programming, each night we choose something. So one of the nights we always do a carnival. And as adults, I would say it's not like the fanciest carnival, but the kids have so much fun. So we set up like bowling pins, and we have a fortune teller. We have tattoos. We have
ring
popcorn and snow cones. We have a photo booth. Some lawn games. And then
throw wet sponges at counselors.
Oh, that's a popular one.
Bingo.
Yeah. Just some games like that. And they get to win prizes when they participate in each of those things. And so, and it's really actually a 2-hour kind of mellow hangout.
That's
time.
The carnival right here.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, the slide.
Yes. Snow cones are very popular at the carnival. It turns into a less structured time where we just kind of have the whole time to just play at the carnival. We're all in one area and the kids can go from game to game. It's fun. 1 year I spent an entire summer like amping it up. I made all these carnival booths out of PVC pipe. It took us an entire day to set it up, and we did it. It was exactly the same amount of fun as the year before. we don't do that anymore. And these are the yurts. We actually purchased the yurts and donated them to the camp so that we could expand our program, because we used to be capped at 55 kids.
Yeah, you don't
okay.
have to watch
this. Any other questions?
How about bedding? Kids need to bring a sleeping bag?
Some kids feel more comfortable in sheets and blankets. They can do that. They can bring a sleeping bag, whatever it is they're comfortable with. They have a bunk. The bunk has like a foam mattress that's like vinyl, you know. So they clean them all off before we get there, which is great. And so whatever they're comfortable with. Yeah.
So my son, in addition to having medications with the prescription label and everything, he has some supplements that are prescribed by his naturopath, including like melatonin for sleep. And vitamin D. Things like that. Is he going to be able to bring those?
Mm-hmm. Yep, just put them in the bag and talk to Heidi about it when you get there. We have a lot of kids on melatonin, and actually that's one of the things she'll ask you when you check in. She asks you about Tylenol, Benadryl, ibuprofen, and melatonin, because if your kid uses it sometimes they just, for whatever reason, somebody might not be anxious at night or something, she might offer that to them. But only if you've said
okay.
Okay, any other questions? Okay, so we will be here for a little bit. If you have any personal questions you want to ask us, we have some swag if you want to come and check it out. We can take payments, but that also can come in online and, I guess,